God in heaven when we go there, and we all want to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. But right now, I ask you to bless the person that's going to bring the word right now. I ask you to lift her up. I ask you to give her peace. I ask her to allow you to just move, the Holy Spirit to move through her as he always does, and let her know that it is well. And so we just ask you to bless everyone in our individual families, near and far. We ask you to bless everyone in our covenant family. We ask for protection and guidance with our leadership, with Apostle Park and Pastor Cordy, Apostle Larry and Prophetess Monette, and all the rest of our leadership and all the rest of us, period. We are all leaders. We are all ministers. We are all missionaries. So Lord, we thank you right now in advance for what you're doing and what you're going to do. And when it's all said and done, we will be ever so grateful to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. And we ask all these things in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. All right. Well, we're just going to play a song here.
Presence of the Lord is here. Presence of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. Presence of the Lord is here. Oh, presence of the Lord is here. Spirit of the Lord is here. Anybody feel it tonight? Spirit of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The Spirit of the Lord is here. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord is here. The power of the Lord is here.
Yes.
The power of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The power of the Lord is here. The power of the Lord is here.
Come on. My baby. I'm my man, baby.
Thank you guys so much for coming on for Bible study. And we have a dynamic, awesome woman of God, and God is just using her, stretching her, and just doing some great things through her. So Denise, I pass it on to you, sweetie.
You're on mute, Denise.
Go downstairs.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Hope.
Yes.
That's the hope. Yes. Did you say Denise? I thought I was sharing the four.
Wait, what's it? I don't, wait, hold on, I'm sorry.
This is the third Wednesday.
Third Wednesday.
Well, thank you, Jesus. Go ahead, my sister. Praise the Lord.
19th, and you have the 26th, which is next Wednesday, Jeanette.
Wonderful.
Yes, amen.
Hold on a minute. Bye. 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 Goodbye. No.
Amen.
Bye. Amen. I can teach. Bye.
Amen. I thought I seen what you could say.
Children.
So how's everyone doing today? Blessed to see another day, right?
All right.
Good.
Amen.
All right.
God.
Yep. Worthy Jesus. Because somebody didn't wake up this morning, so we thank and praise God for just being his presence and just being with other believers, because there's nothing like when you get on a line where you know to have the same spirit. It's just such an awesome experience, because I don't know about you, but some people I'd be around sometimes, I'd just be like, Thank you, Jesus. I need Jesus too, but I'm just saying, it's just good to be, like you said, two or three gathered in his name, he's in the midst. So it's just also good to just be able to fellowship with same Christian like mind. Praising the
Take
same
a deep God. Breath, Denise. It's all right.
Amen. Yep.
I hope this is not weird. I'm doing it like this because I'm not trying to freeze up. So use your phone. Fine.
I do that too, girl.
Yeah.
Amen.
So I actually want to start off with the scripture first. Matthew 23:25-28.
Matthew 23.
Mm-hmm, 25 to 28.
Okay, thank you.
And let me know when you're there. I got everything written down here, so I'm gonna just go for it.
Amen.
Okay, amen.
All right. It reads, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and dish, and then the outside will also be clean. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside, you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside, you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness."
Amen.
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 Woe to you, the Pharisees. I love the way you emphasize hypocrites. She broke that thing down, didn't she? Amen.
So, how many of us have judged or been judged? Right? Probably all of us. We done judged somebody for something, or we've been judged for something that was unfair, right?
Yes.
And based on the outside appearance only.
Right.
I know I've done it.
Yes.
I've judged people, you know, whether it's good or bad, you know, based on how they look. And most of the time I was wrong. And a lot of times they were wrong. So some people, like scripture says, they appear to be righteous, holy. They wear the right things. They say the right things. They know what to say. Like, they have it down pat, right? But that inward man, those thoughts, that heart may be dark, perverted, evil, wicked, all that. But we look at their outer appearance and think, you know, oh, they're perfect. They look, I mean, we know that's not true, but they look like they just never done anything wrong in their life or nothing, right? So none of us are perfect. Amen. But what is the intent of our hearts? The Lord already knew you, me, whoever we, he already knew we'd have a season where we struggle with our flesh. He knew that we'd have a season of shortcomings, of backsliding, of just not living right, just not walking that narrow path, because the other path is so much easier. You know, it's what we know. It's wide. You know, we try to, Pastor Hope, you know, I tried to bargain with God the other day. Remember our conversation? So anyway, with that being said, he knew, you know, that we'd have those moments, those seasons. But God knows your heart. He knows my heart. And it's his grace that has kept you, his grace that has kept me. But it's not... It's not an excuse. Don't allow it, his grace, to be an excuse to sin.
Amen.
To stay in that sin, to stay in that cycle and repeatedly ask for forgiveness. Oh, well, I know God's going to forgive me, you know, like, Yeah, it's okay. I'm just going to repent later. I mean, I know a lot of us probably had those moments, especially like if you're getting ready to cuss somebody out. You know what, God, I'm going to repent for it later. I'm, you know, in my feelings, in my flesh right now. We've had those moments.
Right.
And Jeremiah 17 and 9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand or who can know it? God knows it. He knows our heart.
Yes.
You know, said it to somebody once. I'm like, but God knows my heart. They're like, well, why does everybody say that? Because it's true. He knows our heart. Sometimes we do things and we don't really want to do it, but we do it because everybody else is doing it. We do it because it's a habit, but He knows our hearts. So with that being said, it is important to pray. And this was the first scripture I think I ever remembered, Psalm 51, 10 to 12. Mm-hmm. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Amen. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me.
Yes, yes.
A willing spirit. Yes. So I don't fulfill the lust of my flesh.
Yes.
Sustain me to fight temptation. To stay in your will, God, sustain me.
Amen.
Sustain me, Lord, to the will to fight in the spirit and to not sin. When those feelings arrive, those different things rise up in us to war in the spirit instead of falling into the temptation. Now, I'm not here to talk about temptation tonight, but that is part of it with our heart, because God knows our heart and He knows that a lot of the times we do things, but it's not because we have evil intent. It's just, it's out of habit. So with that being said, I've been judged on my whole outward appearance. I've been judged on my hair. I've been judged on my clothes, my tattoos. I've been judged to my face, and sometimes verbally, or I've been judged just by the stares that I have gotten because I have went to visit another church and they are coming out of the Old Testament, and because I wore pants or because I wore makeup or jewelry, they looked at me differently. Mm-hmm. So the outward appearance doesn't make me any more or any less holy than anybody else.
Amen.
It has nothing to do with the outside.
Amen.
However, the person that did judge me, I have a long list of things that I know about that they've done. Never said nothing to them. I respected them because they were a child of God. I respected them because they had a title. They're a pastor. I respected that person, because it's just how it was, you know. Yeah. And so, but all the time, oh, what's your pastor have to say about you cutting your hair? You're supposed to keep your head covered. What does your pastor have to say about you coloring your hair? What does your pastor have to say about blah, 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 blah? And that's when I said, but God knows my heart. It has nothing to do with how I look on the outside, you know. So with that being said, in that moment, if I really would have been thinking, because I was still very new coming to freedom, and that would have been the perfect moment for Matthew 7:3-5, which says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye.
Amen.
Amen.
So that whole time with the whole judging, and I know I've done it to people, you know, based on how they look, and you know, I feel like, man, that was definitely not the right thing to do, because somebody could look like, I don't know, they could look like they're on something. It could look like they're, you know, a bum, whatever, but she don't know that person might know the word of God inside and out. They just fell on hard times. Mm-hmm. And they're just, they got it. It's here and it's here. But sometimes people fall off and things happen. They just need somebody to help them up. They just need somebody to encourage them. And they might not have that support. So I definitely know what it's like. And you have people who think they're so perfect. They feel like they don't need God. They feel like they got it all together. I've been doing this for a long time. I've been having this title. And yeah, I got it together. And that's when God has to start to humble people, because they're not humble. And so there's always room for change. There's always room for purging, development, and growth. Mm-hmm. We're never too far along that there's always something that can be worked in us. We're works in progress. We're not finished, you know? And so some people just feel like they have, I've arrived, and they really haven't. And Jesus Christ was the only one who was perfect that walked this earth, the only one that was perfect. He was a humble servant, Messiah, and Savior. He was humble. And that's what we're striving to be like. We're striving to be like Christ, to be humble, to help people, to serve people, because we have to go down in order to go up. And John 13:8 was a very good example of Jesus being humble. I believe this was the night before his crucifixion. He said, no, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. I've never read that before. And I prayed on it, and I flipped and I read it, and right away it was revelation, because Jesus came to wash us from all sin. When he washed their feet, that's what that meant. If I can't wash you, you have no part with me. So Jesus came to wash all of sin, filth, and guilt, and shame. Our thoughts, heart, and inner man washed and transformed by the word, by repentance, and allowing God into our hearts, we will be washed and made clean. He's a perfect gentleman. God's not going to bust down the door of our hearts. He's going to knock. He's going to knock, just like the little box that mom has. So he's going to knock. He's just going to simply knock. Will you let me in? Ask God. Will you let me in? Will you let me into your heart? Will you let me come in and cleanse you? Amen. Will you let me come in and make a change in you? Will you let me come in? I need you to cast all of your cares. Will you let me come in and remove those things, those thoughts, that burden, all the things that you went through? Will you let me carry that for you?
Amen.
Will you let me? We hold on to so many things. Like, no, God, I want to hold on to this sin. No, God, because I'm used to it. God, I want to hold on to this person because I'm familiar with that person. God, I want to hold on to the guilt because it makes me feel woe is me, and I like to play the victim. No, God wants us to be victorious.
Amen.
And so he wants to take all that on for us. And we wouldn't allow our guests to stay in our house if it was dirty, right? You know, you get a guest, you want to clean up your house, make sure it looks good. You know what I mean? So we wouldn't allow a guest or a visitor to stay in our home. But the Holy Spirit isn't a visitor. He wants to reside. He wants to dwell in us. So it's time to clean house. Every room, attic,
basement,
those places that we don't want nobody to go into, those rooms where we're hoarding things, that room where it's like, I'm gonna just throw this in there for right now because ain't nobody using that room. God wants to get into all those rooms.
Amen.
He wants to get into those places. The Holy Spirit wants to get in those places and shine light in there. It's time to dust away. It's time to pick up. It's time to throw stuff out. He wants to get into all those places of our dwelling place, and he wants to clean up. We can't do it by ourselves.
Amen.
You know, we try to clean the whole house and we're like, this is too much. We can do some things, but we got to let God do it. We have to let him clean those places in us, those places where we might have forgot about. We have old memories stored in there, the way we felt, stuff just piled up under a rug. It ain't go nowhere. It's just sitting under a rug. We Amen. Need God to come in and clean those places. We need him to clean up all that junk. We can have no part with him unless we allow him to cleanse us. I don't know about y'all, but I need God to cleanse me, because I definitely want to be part with him.
Amen.
I don't want him to, you know, shun me away or any of that. So he wants to clean us up. Allow him to restore you. Amen. Sometimes it's necessary to tear down to rebuild.
Amen.
Because I know when I clean, I'm tearing up the house. I'm tearing up the house. I'm throwing stuff away, whatever I got to do so I can clean up again. And it makes me feel so good. Like, oh yeah, I got rid of all this stuff. I got rid of these things that I don't need, stuff I didn't know I had. Look, I had stuff from middle school before I even know I still had. I'm like, I ain't never wearing that again. I don't need that. I had posters and stuff. I'm like, oh, that's trash. I had bags and bags and bags of trash. You never know how much stuff you have until you have to move.
Yeah.
So Amen. We have those seasons where God wants us to move, but we can't move because we still all got all that stuff, all that junk in our house. So it's time to clean house. He wants to get rid of all that junk because he wants to elevate us, but he can't because we got all this stuff weighing us down. So it's necessary to tear down to rebuild. We were dirty, filthy rags. Dirty, filthy rags. But the blood of Jesus cleansed us. Whether we believe it or not, we are cleansed. We operate sometimes in old ways of thinking, and we you know, like, you know how pigs are? They like to get back in the mud. You clean them up, they're going to get right back in the dirt because it feels good to them, because they're familiar with it. It's what they're used to. They like to be dirty. I don't want to be dirty. He already cleansed me. He already cleansed you. So it's definitely time to stay clean. And he washed us with his blood, whiter than snow. That doesn't make sense to human brain. Like, how can you clean me with blood? Like, I'm going, you know. But his blood was pure. Yeah. He cleansed us. He's coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle or blemish.
Amen.
I'm just going to go there to Ephesians 5, 26 to 27. And it says, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with the water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless.
Amen.
He's looking to come back for us to be clean. We can't do it on our own. We're not going to be perfect, but he wants us to be cleansed. He wants us to be a part of him. He wants to dwell in us. He wants to reside in us. And it's hard to see it that way because we think, oh, well, I've done this and that, and I'm, you know, whatever. Because I know me, I know how my mind is. I think that way sometimes. I'm like, yeah, I'm not doing what I need to be doing. But we know that we're not perfect, but we are progressing.
Amen.
We're progressing. And so I'm like I said, I'm just as guilty of judging, critiquing somebody else's walk. How dare I judge them? Because I don't know what they're going through. I can't fit their shoes. I don't know what's going on up in their mind. I don't know. So how dare I critique how they're living? It's a perfect time to seek God on how to pray for that person. Because in that same season, We don't know. We might experience that. Mm-hmm. We might have already experienced that. And how soon we forget, oh man, I was going through the same thing. I was doing the same crazy stuff. But we want to, not us, but I'm just saying in general, just, and it happens so quickly, like, look at her. She ain't been to church in I don't know how long. And oh, she, you know, she got herself a husband now and she thinks she whatever, whatever. And I've seen it, it happens. So we don't want to be like that. We want to just pray for that person. Like, I don't know what they're going through, but it's time for me to pray for them instead of talking about them, instead of gossiping about them. Let me pray for them because I don't know what they're going through. I don't know what's going on. Something's different. Something changed. Something switched up. And sometimes we can't get through to people. Excuse me. Get out of my room. Thank you very much. Coming here for snacks. Lord Jesus. So, like, bye. Get out. So it's like, we got to pray for them, and no judgment, no condemnation for those who are in Christ.
Right.
And God may convict our hearts to pray for the believers and the non-believers, because we know not everybody's a believer. And, you know, if somebody's messing up and they're not a believer, that's our perfect time to pray for them. And if they're, you know, against us praying for them in that moment and praying with them, we pray for them in our prayer closet, in our private time, you know, to pray. So it's just, we just never know. So instead of being so quick to judge people's outer appearance, and, you know, because I know I've done it, I'm like, oh man, they seem like, man, they their walk is so great and whatever, but they struggling too. Yeah. Like the one of us is suffering, we're all suffering with the same type of things, the whole body of Christ. We're all going through spiritual warfare. And that's why it's so important for us to keep each other prayed up. And I know some of us are like, well, I already know that, but it was just something, you know, it's what God had gave me. And I had these for a while here. And it just makes me think about, man, I got to make sure I'm keeping people prayed up, instead of being mad because somebody's not getting on prayer, or mad because somebody's not getting on Bible study and I feel like they should be getting fed. That is not up to me. I can't make them get on. You know, we can feed people, but they don't, we can present them with the food, but if they don't want to eat, they won't want to eat. We can't force feed them, shove it down throats. We can't do any of that. So gotta just pray for them and say, my brother and sister, I'm not really feeling them, like when with Adam in the garden, when God was asking him where he wasn't talking about physically, he was talking about spiritually, because he couldn't feel him. And sometimes we don't feel people. So that's the time when we got to keep them prayed up instead of judging them. But like, man, I don't know why they ain't come to church. So look, trust me, I've been like that. I'll be getting mad at people. They don't even know I'm mad at them. I'm like, they ain't even coming. They're not even getting on. What's going on with that? That's not for me to worry about, but I just got to pray for them. So just wanted to say, you know, not to judge people on their outer appearance or based on, you know, certain things, but just keep them prayed up. And this is a short one. That's all I've got. That's
Amen.
It.
Amen.
Great word. Definitely food for thought for sure. That's
Amen.
Good.
Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Well, we'll leave it open for anyone that has some words of wisdom or just want to share something, you know, pertaining to the message. That was definitely was a good word, Denise. I thank you so much for God to use you on that, because that could be an area where you had to be obedient to hear God to be able to speak that word. And so I thank you so much for just your obedience and you know, for us to just meditate on it. And it's just really, really good, because we all got a place where we have to, it's just self-inventory. Basically, that's what it all boils down to, self-inventory. So I love it when you said we're not perfect, but see, I remember mom always say that we're not perfect, but we're perfect in Christ. So he has to do it. He's there for us to be perfect, not perfect, but you know what I'm saying? Like, we can't overcome obstacles without the presence of the Lord. And I love the part about the whole heart thing. You know, I say that daily. I probably say it more hourly sometimes about create me a clean heart and a right spirit in me, because we all want to make sure our heart lines up with God's heart.
Amen.
Not what we feel, not how we think, or what somebody said or what somebody didn't say. It's like you always want to, well, I do want to be able to make sure my heart is clean with him in the spirit, and you know, and have that right spirit, you know. So, and I love the way that you said, you know, he's a perfect gentleman. He's not going to knock down, open our hearts. Like, our hearts have so many doors to open. So like you said, it could be somebody's past, something somebody got offended about, or generational thing many, many years ago. And then as soon as somebody says something, it could reopen and revisit. And here we go again. You never even dealt with that you didn't even know that you might even had a problem with. You know what I'm saying? So it's just so good that you are able to minister that. And it's always a, you know, self-inventory. And when you were talking about you can't judge people, and remember Deacon Say, he played that video of the homeless guy, and he knew God's word upside and down. But if you'd have seen him walking down the street, you know, just that personal appearance, you wouldn't even think that he was full of God, you know, like he knew God's word, you know. So, you know, that's just really, I don't know. I just, it's good. That's all I can say is good. And I like the part that you said about moving, you know, we got to move in certain areas and get rid of some old stuff for God to really take us to our next season of our life. And it's so funny because the Lord has been having me for the last month just get rid of stuff. And I've just really been getting rid of things, you know, so it's so good. But then it's also a spiritual, you know, like you said, it's the inside. It's not the outside. We can move stuff. We can throw stuff away and all of that. But just what's in the inside of us, that we need to ask God to get rid of those things in those areas in our life. So I thank you so much. It's definitely an awesome word. And I just know that's what I've been at and what about now. So, you know.
Amen. Amen.
Sometimes silence is golden.
Amen. Amen.
I tell you what, I know whatever you go through, especially when you're doing something wrong, God always send a word.
Amen.
Because I was doing some judging this day.
All right.
But I knew I was wrong. So when I got home, I was angry. So when I got home, and it's so funny because I did say it. I said, God, you don't forgive me. Because I always ask God, let me see it the way
you see.
He see.
Right. Yeah.
But, you know, sometimes people will say things to you, you know, like they push a button. You try to be political correct sometimes. You know, I'm dealing with a lot of people that's Catholic, you know, where I work at. And, you know, they're talking about, oh, well, you know, I did my good deeds.
Yeah.
And you know, like even when I was in the world, I never put a bad word before holy, a bad word before Christ. And they do it so much where it bothers me.
Right.
And you know, and I was judgmental about certain things. Like, I guess because living in the world, I know how it feels to be money hungry. And where it led me. And so I'm not like that. So right. I just feel today, well, this whole week, I feel like it's okay for y'all to beat the system, but if I did it, it's a problem. And it really offended me, you know what I'm saying? Because I feel like we be milking the clock. I don't want to milk the clock. One thing I learned, God made me realize, I live within my means. I learned to do that. So I don't look for extra stuff. I don't look to beat the system or steal. And I feel it's okay as long as y'all doing it. But if I was doing it, y'all be, you know, so I became judgmental and I really shouldn't, even though it was wrong. God said you could judge in truth. You know, so I can't say I was judging in truth. I'm going to be honest. I was judging out of anger because I more or less I'd ready to go.
Yeah. Yeah,
I don't look for the extra money. If it come honestly, I'm grateful. But amen. It wasn't coming honestly. Basically, you're doing things to kill a clock, and it's boring me. Like, maybe because I didn't tell them I had Bible study. I know y'all don't want to hear it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I be wanting to do other things. I can't steal, whether it's lying on my taxes or anything. You know, like, I ask God to cleanse me. So you gotta realize, even when these things come across my mind, you know, God convict me just for even thinking
it, right?
Yeah.
Right.
You know, so it's a lot of things. Like I said, maybe I just felt I was judgmental. Maybe I took it the wrong way. And I know a lot had to do with it. I just wanted to get out of there. I can use it. Don't get me wrong. I can add to my tithes and my offering.
That's right.
But it's not coming honest. You understand what I'm saying? Like, y'all stealing. I know if I did it, y'all, you know what I'm saying? Y'all be on told the office on me.
Hello.
No, that's real.
Yeah. Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? So I kind of got offended, and, you know, and I just, you know, I'm at the bottom. I don't really run nothing. I just don't want to, I'm not a thief. I never was a thief. I only lie to get out of jail. I mean, and we going to be honest. You know, and I just wanna live right. And I can't pick and choose anymore. Right. To what I'm gonna be good at and what I'm not going, what I'm gonna be faithful to, or what I'm not gonna be faithful to. And like I said, a lot I had to do, I wanted to go, but at the end of the day, we still were still in the time. Yeah. You know, and I don't wanna be a part of that scenario. You know what I'm saying? And you know, that's all. And I ask God for forgiveness. So you put me in a better position not to be doing stuff like that, you know? So that's that. So I'm just glad Denise said that, because I was, man, today, shoo, I was reading people. And I shouldn't. And I was, you know, I'm just got my aunts, my grandmother, my sister, my brother, you know what I'm saying? I'm learning, like, I want to be, if I can't be honest with y'all, then it don't make no sense to me even living. That's how I feel. You know, if I can't come to y'all and look for the goodness and be directed in the right path, then, I don't want to say I love God in vain, you know?
Right.
Like, and I, you know, believe me, I'm terrible today. I ain't say no bad word, but my demeanor wasn't Christ-like. You know what I'm saying? I want to be able to show people, you know, a better way. I need to learn a better way to direct my action, because people are looking at it. So you got to realize, people feel they do good deeds. That's all you need to get into heaven. You don't have to be right no other times of the year. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's crazy how people think. You know, because a lot of them say, yo, yeah, I'm a Catholic and I did my good deed. I ain't seen none of the good deeds since I've been there. You know, so, I love y'all.
Well, I just encourage you, and I thank you so much for just being open and transparent, because it's real. And I think, again, Denise, of you just hearing God, because it was an on-time word, you know, for all of us. I mean, it was just good. But I just encourage you, Deacon Say, it's just like, always remember, and I've been in situations like that, because then it's like, you want to know, like, I don't want to do all this. Like, this is just extra, and y'all doing extra, you know, even for my employees, I can even say that, you know I pay you a certain amount or whatever the case may be for the time. And like, I just say, Lord, you know, yeah. You know, and then it's like, God, he's our rewarder and not man. And you got to always remember that. So you're working unto the Lord at your job, and you're going to represent God as your with your job. And so even though you might feel a certain kind of way, but still, God knows, here we go again, God knows your heart, that didn't sit well with you, regardless of what they look like and what they seen and what they was feeling. And God's still going to reward you of your obedience, because he knows. And even for you to make this confession, you know what I'm saying? Or not confession, but just, because that sounds like Catholic, making confessions, but just being able to express yourself. No, because, I mean, some people just don't want to be real and be honest, and this is what Bible study really is all about. So for you to explain how you felt, like, you're human, but at the same token, I want you to be encouraged and keep on knowing, like, God's your rewarder and not man. And so that's where I feel like I can't worry about what man thinks. I can't worry about what man says. I'm trying to live what God wants me to do, and that's right. it. And he says in his word that God is our rewarder and not man.
Amen. And I just don't want to use excuses because of my emotions for one thing and then reacted because this is going on, you know? And that's why I said what I said. And, you know, sometimes, you know, I'm like, what Denise did that. I'm like, yo, come on, God, for real?
Like, I love it. I love it.
You know, like, can I get one outburst?
No, he knew where you were at today. Yeah, so that's why he knew that you were going to be on here. And really, I felt from what you shared with me, you was just frustrated because you was ready to get on Zoom so you can get your word. So that's nothing wrong with that. You know what I mean? So you was ready to go.
I'm learning, like, I preach, like, man, I'm saying some good words. I said I preach when I said, you know, I want to be, you know, it was a time I didn't want to get on, do services, you know what I'm learning? Like, I want to be joyful while I'm doing it. And I'm ready to go. I don't, because, you know, when you get in here and you tired, that's when the devil start working with you. Yes. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, and I was just telling my wife, because today my daughter's birthday, she wanted to do it. I like, yo, look, I got Bible study. Y'all be knowing. Y'all already know. God be answering these prayers. But they understand. You know what I'm saying? And I just want to be, I want to be true. See, that's the whole thing with me. Like, I ain't into phony stuff. You know what I'm saying? So if I'm going to be on Bible study, I want to be true. If I read my word, I ask God even let me, like I said, I might not comprehend everything, but let me get something out of it.
Yeah, amen. Amen.
Something that's for the good.
Yes.
Amen. You know, so I'm just so thankful for Denise, because that's what I said about this covenant. I know we realize how blessed we are with this covenant, because I don't think there's a covenant out there like this. And I'm not saying we better than other people. You understand what I'm saying? That's not what I'm saying. But I realize how blessed we are. You know, so I value that.
Amen.
Amen.
You understand? See, I value my covenant more than I ever value a dollar.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? Because everybody trying to get that dollar. I ain't trying to get it. I'm trying to get his word.
Amen.
You know, because I know that's where my blessing at. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not going to buy no scratch or, you know what I'm saying? What I know God dealing with me, it's not for me to hold inside and keep it for myself. I always talk about the talent. And Denise, I'm not trying to take your night, girlfriend. Believe me, I'm not trying to take your night. But you just, I just love what you said, because you got to understand when we minister to one another, it just opened up the doors of ministry just to be explored through everybody, and for that feeling to be expressed throughout the whole covenant. You know what I'm saying? Where even if we spoke different languages, we will all be on one accord.
One accord. Amen.
Spirit.
Amen. And that's what's so remarkable about fellowship. That's why the word tells us not to forsake, you know, gathering together, like-minded, because that's what it's all about. You know, Denise had a word from the Lord.
That's right.
You had an issue today. So what God does is he uses Denise as a vessel, not just to minister to all of us, but to a specific need that you had. But what you need to know, you are put in that position for a reason.
That's right.
And I'm starting to realize that.
You are there to glorify and exemplify who God is.
Amen.
And so you're going to have these challenges that you had today, because your job is, that's what your job is to do, is to make a difference in that place. And the enemy wants you to fail.
Yeah.
He wants you to fail wholeheartedly so they can say, oh, and you call yourself a Christian. But you got to know you're in the right place, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with you confessing to your family.
That's right.
Because when you're confessing to us, you're confessing to God. And Amen. What he's going to do is strengthen you from this experience to the next time when it happens, you'll deal with it a little better.
You just passed the test by making your confession. That's basically what you
Amen.
So it's like,
that's what I didn't blow up and say anything, but I know my body language spoke some values today.
Yeah, well, I saw like, you wiping your eyes and stuff.
No, because the pollen, being out there in the fields and stuff around nothing but farmland, man, my eyes are pitch red.
Okay.
And it's been like that for 2 days now, and I know it's the pollen and stuff in the air out there, you know? So, but I had to get the Bible study. Like, I'm starting some eye drops. Yeah.
All right.
I've been cleaning. My wife said she's going to bring me some Visine, but like for the last two, like it's been like 2.5 years since I went back to work. Another week, man. My allergies and everything just erupted. Like I never felt this bad, but I know I'm around nothing but farmland and the weather changing out there.
Yeah.
And we out there 10 to 12 hours a day. So I'm just thankful for I'm thankful for you, Denise, and you know, for even having that word and God, here you go again. You know, like,
I know, but that just lets you know that he heals your heart. That's where when it happens to me, I get so excited. I'll be like, oh God, you heard my heart. I didn't have to say nothing, but you heard my heart and you're speaking through somebody just to tell me that you heard me, reassured that you're hearing my cry. You know, you hear my prayers. So it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. And like I was saying about one of my employees where she's just messy. Like she's messy and she knows about God and all the above and XYZ. And she thinks because I know God too, but she just like you say, manipulate the system or just try to maneuver. And I'm just like, Lord, I don't understand. They're not doing it to me. They're doing it to you. You know what I'm saying? And so when you have that different perspective of how you look at it, you can't get mad. You know what I'm saying? You can feel a certain kind of way, but after a while, like you just received your breakthrough in it. The next time it happened, it's not going to bother you as bad. You know what I mean?
And I'm going to go in tomorrow a better, you know, because the only thing she ain't say, and I thought she was going to hit on it when he called, he said, when Jesus said, you whitewashed tomb. You know, it could do that. Really, all those scriptures mean a lot because it dealt, because we got to, you know, the Bible says you got to die daily.
That's right.
And that's part of the washing. You know what I'm saying? Right. So, you know, that's why I said, man, come on, God. Not, you know, someday you just want to have that outburst. It's been a minute since I had an outburst. I don't know what it is to have an outburst because it's been so long. But I'm thankful that, you know, because I am so grateful that the Lord chastises me.
Absolutely.
He chastises those that he loves. Mm-hmm.
You just got to know the difference between condemnation and convicted. That's the difference. You got to know the difference. When you know the difference, then it's okay to receive that conviction and walk in love, regardless if it hurts or not, you can still walk in love with it. But that condemnation thing, woe is me and all that, like that's not God.
Right.
So. Thank you. God is blessed.
Now, because we are all experiencing it. Like, Denise, you really heard God on that. Like, you hit so many areas that I'm just like, God, I don't even have to say nothing. She said everything.
Yeah.
You know, I thank you for hearing my cry. I thank you for hearing my prayer. So, like, it's just amazing. And I just thank you for just having godly boldness, spiritual boldness to be able to share a message like that you heard God, because that's a sticky situation when it comes to people, because some people can take it personal and some people can just take it the wrong way.
And but
just
you know,
you being transparent is just amazing. So I thank God for you again. I'm sorry, Pastor Carolyn.
That's okay. But you know, one of the things that you know I want to say is that you know, this road that we're traveling is some folks that pretend to be on the road, but they're not on the same road. Mm-hmm. And like she said, with the whitewash, you can look the part, know when to lift holy hands, know when to shout hallelujah, know when to do your dance, but you ain't about God in no kind of way, you know? And so we get tricked a lot, you know, but what happens is when you see those folks like that, you don't judge them. What we need to do is pray for them. Because I was in church for a lot of years with people that came to church every Sunday, two services, went to Bible study, and anything else, anytime the doors was open, they was there. But come tax time, they was using somebody else's kids to file their taxes. You know what I'm saying? And they call themselves Christians. So they look good from the outside, but when you're doing stuff like that, you might be tricking the government, you might be getting away with whatever you're doing with your people, but God knows you and he knows your heart and he knows everything that you do and why you're doing it.
Yeah, that's so awesome about him.
You know.
That's so awesome. And I think for me, when I first became like a Christian and really taking this thing seriously, my expectations of Christians was so high because I dealt with people in the world. So I know what they act like and what they look like inside and out and the characteristics and all that. So then when you go to church and you thinking like, okay, I'm trying to live this right and do the right thing for Jesus. And then my piercing and my conviction, but just like my surprise is like, oh my gosh, I just like Mike from down the street, you know what I'm saying? And I'm like, what? And so I had to get myself together and realize, and there was a pastor that told me at a young, you know, when I was a babe in Christ and said, he's still a man. He's still this. And I could not comprehend it because I knew when I was coming to the Lord, it was like a marriage, a commitment. Like, I'm not going to mess around with this thing. I'm not going to date you. I'm not going to have an affair with you. I want to be married to you and be committed.
Right.
To you. So when I thought all of us had that same concept, and when I realized that it didn't, that kind of quenched my spirit a little bit. And I have to be honest, but after a while, you're like, you can't, and it's okay. But it's just like, I really thought, and I knew one time my friend, she was a pastor, first lady, and her husband. And I'm telling you, I did not notice for the longest time, but they go to church, like you said, the Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, Sunday, whatever, all the above. And she would go home and he would beat her.
Yeah.
And I just could not believe it. And I have a problem with that because I grew up like that. So I'm ready to snatch his neck and break, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm ready.
Come get me.
You know what I'm saying? And I was, because I was like, are you kidding me? Like, and I didn't like that because I was just a new babe in Christ. Like, when I'm seeing you doing this and this is what you preaching and this is what you're doing, like, I don't even want, if this is the God that you serve, I don't even know if I really want to fool with you like that or fool with God like that. So sometimes we got to be careful because we lose our witness to other people. Because I did not, was like, what? Mike, you acting like Mike, you acting like, you know, I can't aim for him. You know what I'm saying? And so I have to be honest, like, that's how I was at the beginning of my walk, you know, and then God had to just let me know, like, keep your focus on me. You, like Denise said, keep on praying for him and see if you can help him and stuff like that, because God will show you. Because that lady, she just had to tell me one day, because people's like, oh, they think my marriage is so good and this, that, and third. She was like the one that Apostle Nam always talked about, when the wife ain't right, the man ain't the husband.
Yeah.
Or, you know, looking, yeah, she was one of those. You know what I'm saying?
So I knew my wife that if I was preaching, would she do that?
Yeah.
And no, but I'm just dead serious until one day she had a connection. And I just was like, what?
She had to hear him.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I was in my flesh at first, and I just said, nope, you know what? I got to stay in the spirit, because it took me a while to adjust to that. I have to be honest. I really did have to adjust to that, because I just thought when you got committed to the Lord, you was going to be sold out.
I think
everybody's not. And what happens is, when we commit ourselves seriously to becoming children of God, we come wholeheartedly when we're really about him. And so that's why a lot of times you'll hear a lot of songs that were sung years ago that the most painful hurt you can receive is in the house of God. Because when you go in there, you're going looking for hope. You're going looking for love. You're going looking for people that's going to understand you and help you. And when that doesn't come, thank God, hope, that your spiritual man at the time you did come in, even though you were a babe, but that spiritual man was strong enough to hold you up above the mess that you were seeing. Because it's frustrating. We've lost a lot of new Christians because they see the other side of the coin. And they like you said, JoJo do that.
Yeah.
Down the street, you know, so what am I gonna sit in here for?
I know me and Dad was
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Dan.
Talking one time, and I know one of the conversations was, you know, how the church was growing and how people just started fading away. And I had to tell them that you got to understand, a lot of people are now, and I use me as an example, a lot of people didn't really come to be saved. A lot of people just came to be helped. Yes. And some of them got help. But then we talk about the parable of the seeds.
Yes.
You know, and he just, and you know, he just looked at me, and you know, and I said, you gotta understand, the word is so true. And if you start submitting to the word, God is gonna open up not just your heart, but your eyes to see a lot of things. I sit down with my kids, especially when they want to be fundamental. That's the best time to get them, because you gotta understand, when we talk, they expect the pastor, the preacher, the minister, the prophet, they have no flaws.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and I always tell those are ones you better watch. Because, you know, they were like, well, I'm going to tell Dad on you. I said, it's nothing Dad and Mom don't know. Because anything I do that's outside that might seem wrong to y'all, I always admit. You know what I'm saying? And I know sometimes I have to talk to them on their level, because they don't really, sometimes some people just don't understand good English. I mean, I don't go outside the lines or anything, but sometimes I have to get cocky with them. You know what I'm saying? I'm still their father. You know, I got to let them know these hands still move. You know, and they be like, I'm telling Pastor Monette and Apostle Larry, and I was like, well, get them on the phone. It's nothing you can tell Dad. That's one thing I could say. There's nothing you could tell him that I haven't told. Like, I mean, I had told him, and I'm glad I'm able to go to him. And I think that was the biggest issue with the men in the church. Like, they really didn't, you know, they didn't really want to open up about, you got to, one thing, you can't be half truthful. Because when you start becoming half truthful, you become a full liar.
Okay. All right.
Oh.
All right, that's good.
And that's the problem, like, with the men's, man. Even when, you know, like, I miss all the men's. Like, I think a lot of them don't be bothered with me because of Dad. I don't have an everyday relationship with Dad. But I know you have to, it's not about Dad. Once you open up and get right and submit to God, you will always be honest with your apostle, your pastor, your ministry. And that opens up the door for growth with us. And I think that, like I said, I mean, when I first started, you know, you look for flaws. Mm-hmm. When you first get into ministry, you look for flaws. You look for that exit.
Yep.
And people just don't want to be honest about it. You actually look for the flaw. You even when you read certain things in the Bible, like, but in this chapter said that. But until you start allowing God and the Holy Spirit have His way with you, is the only way you're gonna start understanding. That's why Jesus said not everybody would understand the parables. Right. Only those that believe would understand. And you know, and like I said, a lot of time, I love our company because everybody got a different form of manifesting it, the word to people, and it opened up the door for everybody to achieve different elements with each individual. Like, you know, if you preach on something, an apostle come, I might not get it from you. But when he come back and reinnovate, because that's the goodness of this covenant, because somebody will always bring that chapter back into existence and form that book.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, teach that Bible. You know, because all of y'all that really know the Bible, you could, y'all all be on one accord. You, I mean, like, you can, if you looking for it, you can get it.
All right.
You know? And that's when you know it's on. That's why I said I looked for that to that one point. I couldn't find it, so it lined me up to be on one accord. Amen. I used to be jealous in certain little areas about how y'all would preach and how intellect y'all was. And one day I just tell God, I said, God, love, I like being funny because I think he's funny. So let me have humor. Because and then I realized when I start feeling jealous, all of y'all funny. Like we all funny. Yeah, like everybody funny.
Amen.
Everybody got good, you know what I'm saying? Like everybody got good humor. Like we sit up there, we laugh, we giggle, we crack up. Everybody, I mean, it's like, I be talking about like all the time. Like she might not always be in the picture, but she'll be on the side and you could, I think old teaching, people felt like they had to sit up like this in a suit, be uncomfortable, mm-hmm. can't wait to get out of church, mm-hmm. you know? But when the kids are here, my wife and them sit back and see how, because they listen. Remember, they looking for the exit too.
Right.
They listening. And they see me here cracking up and here. I tell her all the time, I tell my wife all the time, I have fun. You don't know how much, I said, for people not to be on weed and alcohol and able to have the fun that we have during serving, you can't get better than that.
Amen.
You cannot get better than that.
You get punched drunk.
You know what I'm saying? You're not waking up with a hangover unless it's the Holy Ghost.
All right.
You know, and she be like, you know, I think she's starting to really understand it's meant to enjoy. It's meant to have fun. It's meant to live a good life. And I think that is the problem. People don't feel you could go to church and live God's way and not have a good time and not live in harmony.
Amen. Amen.
Well, I can honestly agree to that because the churches that I've gone to, because I grew up in a Baptist, you got to be quiet. You can't say amen, hallelujah. I mean, you can say it, but you know, if it's through worship, but going to other churches, you couldn't be yourself and be open. And that's why I love so much about this covenant, because it's freedom. You could be yourself. You can, you know, express or whatever, and you still just, it's okay. You know, and that's what I learned with this church is that you can be, you don't have to be so sniffed at. Because the last church I went to, the lady, she was like, I want you to be close to my pastor so you can do her hair on Sunday mornings before church. What? Like, I couldn't understand that part. Like, why do I want to, you know, I'm just saying the stuff that you can see in previous churches. And then when you go to something where it's open and free, you know, Pastor Carol, you know, our conversation before we even came on here, you know what I'm saying? That was humor right there, you know? So amen. It's just a beautiful amen. Thing. But say, I want to tell you this, this is what Dr. Stanley told me this, I heard him one time talk about hope. When you're hungry, you're angry, you're lonely, you're tired. Those are the four tactics that the enemy will try to come and attack you every single time. So when I feel like my flesh is rising up or I'm feeling a little warm, I always got to check those. Am I hungry? You know what I'm saying? Am I angry? Am I lonely? Am I tired? And now I have to check myself. So those are like some key triggers me where I'm not, you know what? I only had 2 or 3 hours of sleep today, so I'm gonna really walk in love on this one. And I have to tell myself that, you know what I'm saying? Where I'm not taking a personal of whatever the situation is. So we do have tactics, you know, to be able to overcome where we won't lose our witness to someone else.
Amen. Amen.
So, and it's a learned behavior. Because
trust me. Go ahead, Bob, because I see you.
They talking about you, Jeanette.
Yeah, I was trying to.
She got some ready to bust open. She ready to come through. So come
on. I see you.
You close us out in prayer, Mom Jeanette, after you, because I know you got words of wisdom. And thank you so much, Pastor Carolyn. That's what I love so much about this and the, you know, Bible study where we can just interact and just be able to share our stories and where we come from and, you know, just experiences. Like, I've been with you. I've been where you're at. So Denise, again, thank you so much for allowing us to meet you. And I was like, that she in my message. Now I wasn't being like jealous or anything like that. I'm not saying that whatsoever. It's just like, okay, Lord, that just gives me confirmation. I'm on the right page because that's where it was like, create me a clean heart and right spirit. So we on the same page. So I thank you so much. And you're a friendly reminder. I need to stay there.
Amen. Amen.
Because if you have the same message, the Holy Spirit, when that message is for right now, everybody got that message who's hearing from the Lord.
Amen.
Because that's what he's giving out.
Amen.
In some kind of form, it's going to come out. Creating me a new heart and the right spirit. Creating.
Yes.
I just want to say, like, Denise, I don't know. Sometimes you seem like you said that you can't bring the word or something. You are so awesome, girl. Yes. And you haven't seen nothing yet because God is really going to use you. I mean, you got to pack down now.
Yes.
I think you need some more faith. I think you should have a little bit more faith than you, you know, you've been done turn out our little window pane here. Talking. You present yourself so well and you allow the Lord to use you because truly you hear from the Lord and you love the Lord. Don't worry about all the negative things and you're trying to do right for the Lord because God don't need your help.
All right now.
He already know what you're gonna do today and what you did yesterday. He already know what you're gonna do all next week. He has your life already planned out.
Yes.
So you shouldn't even worry about what you're doing negative because he already know. But he has the time to fix it for all of us.
All right.
Me too. Yeah. Today might not be the day that something you did that you was worried about or something. It might not be the day God want to deal with you with that.
Amen.
So just be patient.
That's right.
And all you have to do, he wants you to learn his word and be a doer of his word.
Yes.
Walk upright.
Yes.
Share his word with people. But you know, it's that Satan. He's a schemer. He comes to rob, steal, and destroy. And we keep forgetting who we wrestle against, not flesh and blood, but principalities, rulers of darkness in high places.
I call
and that goes for all of us.
Amen.
We keep trying to make ourselves fit in the word of God to help God. And he got us thrown off.
Amen.
He got us going over his way. And ha, ha, ha.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go over there. Hey, I'm not even going to do it because then I'll be talking. I'm not even going to say it.
I mean, we're already past our time. So just the people's time sake.
Because I wanted to say,
can,
that's
but
why when Jesus went to the to be tempted, he always said, when Satan said, hey, if you so and so and so on, jump over this mountain, you know, because he was hungry and everything. But he just said, get ye behind me, Satan. I don't live on bread alone, but everything proceeds out of my mouth. So all the negativity, you have to have a word of God to say right when the negativity comes, fighting the good fight of faith. And that is so hard to do. Now I'm talking it. But I'd be challenged every day.
Amen.
Sometimes, lots of times.
Amen.
Every day.
Amen.
I forget somewhere in the day to do that. But if we practice, we'll become stronger.
That's right.
And we won't, you know, feel that we are not in the army because we are. God has already equipped you.
Yes.
All of us.
Yes.
And I'm like, I wish I could read it and plan it out like you did and then tell the story about it.
Mm-hmm.
So nice and clear and everything. The anointing there. That's good.
But your gift is what you have and her gift is what she has.
Oh.
You do what you do with perfection and she does what she does with perfection.
Yeah, well, just like I just said, We always trying to help God out. I said, I wish. See, just like that. But God, I am at peace with where you have me.
Amen. See,
that's what you have to throw back at the enemy.
That's right. That's right.
That, I don't know why.
I am not. I don't want what you have. I want what God has for you. Me.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
See, that's right. What I'm talking about. We're not even aware. Oh, we do those things. But God is, he has outlined our lives before we was in our mother's womb. Yeah. I know that much. I don't worry about it that much because I keep some of those scriptures and just say, yeah, I'm going to go on that one.
Amen.
And Deacon say, if you was just angry and you didn't show any force to the people.
That's right.
God said you can be angry, but sin not. So I don't think you sin it because you didn't go tell nobody how you feel.
That's right. That's
you didn't choke nobody. Did you?
No, I really didn't say nothing, but you know my walk changed. And they already know it was the hood walk. whole different walk.
And I just want to, before Jeanette prays, I just want to say something. Pastor Hope, you said something about the Baptist church that you were in. They were all uptight and you couldn't do. Well, Jeanette, we have to tell them they don't know about real Baptist churches, do they? Because, baby, our Baptist churches we had here at Williamsport, oh, we got down.
I know, because when I went to a Kojic church, Church of God in Christ, I said, ooh, they party. Like, I like going here because...
Well, that's not a Baptist. That's not Baptist.
Okay, but I'm just saying, like, yeah, I've been to other churches after when I grew up, and I'm like, wow, because you had to wear a suit, you had to be a certain kind of way. But Denise, I do have to share this, and it was in my spirit, and I'm going to let y'all go on this one, Pastor, you can just pray. But when I was in the world, just... everything was great. Dress 9 to 10. Like if I didn't have this, that, and a third or whatever the case may be. So when I came to the Lord, I came with nothing. I was 3 months pregnant. I only had $30 in my pocket and I was homeless. Y'all know my story, but I gave it all up because I wanted to see what this Jesus thing looks like. So then I started hanging around Christian people and this girl, one of my best friends still to this day, oh, you need to dress up a little bit. You need to do your hair better, dress this certain kind of way. Nobody's gonna like you. You're not doing this. And so if I didn't know who I was, I would be stuck. So that's why I admire when I see beauty, when I be like, Pastor Vi, you sharp. Mom, you know what I'm saying? Like, I like to give compliments. And that's the reason why, because I thought when I came into this walk with Christ, you had to look like the people with the long skirts and, you know, no makeup, no nothing and all the above. So even with that, you can get misunderstood about that situation of what you're supposed to look like as a Christian. But when my friend told me that, and I could have, if I didn't know who I was, I could have took it personal on her and I could have really kind of flipped on her on the other end, be like, girl, you don't know me. You know what I'm saying? But I knew God was changing me. And so I didn't say anything. I got home and I just got on my knees and I started praying. I was like, thank you, Lord. I want to get to the point where I'm not standing out. I'm glad I blend in and all the above. So I praised him so much. The next day, this lady says, I cleaned out my closet and she gave me all these clothes. I mean, like, high end clothes, this, that, and the third, because I thought that I needed to just don't have nothing because I wanted Jesus. So even through that, it could be misunderstood because you're looking at the outside and don't even know. My heart was so pure. I'm stripping myself away from everything just so I can see what this Jesus thing looks like.
Right.
You know, so then if we wear a bling or we wear a dress up, like I'm amazed where I was like, and I still compliment. And so my compliments are genuine. Yes, they are sincere because I thought you had to be a certain kind of way. And then when I went to a church, I was wondering, I had a suit on and a pantsuit, and they was looking at me like you said, you wear pants. Some churches, you don't wear pants. And I'm like, well, I don't even know how to go. Even the thrift stores, those long skirts that go down to the ankles and all of that, like the splits is so high. So you might as well have on a shirt or skirt anyway. So like, I could not understand, you know, with this whole appearance thing on the outside. So what you're saying again is so good because really it's what the inside is and what's in the inside coming out. So I just wanted to share that. I don't know why I had to say that, but you could be misunderstood even just not knowing of dress attire. That girl, she could have broke my feelings and hurt my feelings if I didn't know who I was.
Right, that's right.
You look dusty. Basically, that's what she said. That's a world term, dusty. But you know what I'm saying? She's just like, you, I mean, because that's the way I interpret it. She just said, you need to get yourself together. You need to dress up a little bit. You need to do this, do your hair, and this, that, and the third. And I was just like, wow, God, I was just rejoicing in my heart. Like, wow, they don't see that glamour. They don't see that glitz. They don't see all of that. So I was excited. I really was, and I still get excited. You know what I'm saying? Because it's like, praise God. And then when I come to our church, it's like, oh, you can have a little flavor. Pastor Carolyn, you won me over with wigs all day long, okay? Like, I just was like, do you got some names for them? You know, I mean, I know that sounds crazy, but it's just like, and even with that, some people even get that misunderstood.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? About your hair, the this, that, the third, and it's okay, but it's like, it's in my, it's good. It's okay, because my heart is right. You know what I'm saying? It's like, my friends and them back then, they could have dogged me out if I didn't know, and I probably wouldn't even want to go to church because I ain't had nothing to wear.
Yeah.
Because I gave all my stuff
back. About what people think.
But I'm saying,
people
like,
throw you off.
Judging you, and if you don't know who you are in Christ, you can be really misled. That's why you don't have a judge robe on. You can't look at what everybody, like that homeless man, he was filled with the word. So Amen. You can't look on the outside.
Amen. Amen.
I'm just saying. So, yep.
Angela. Hi.
Is Angela on?
She just sit there and she don't say a word.
I can't see anybody because I haven't. I know you tell me I can do the whole gallery, but I just keep it just whoever speaking and it just shows up. So, okay. I don't know. I apologize, Angela. We love you. Say something because last week we really let say no. His awesome message was on point.
She prays good.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes, you do.
What?
You know, Hope, one of the things you can do is on the bottom of your screen, it has a participant thing.
Okay.
If you click that, what it does to your right, it shows you everybody that's on. So even though you have the personal one on whoever's speaking, you can still see who's on.
Yeah, okay. I see it. Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
Say something, Angela.
She did. Angela. She said hi.
Oh. Okay, so.
Oh my God.
I had a little challenging week starting Sunday. So my niece that was in an accident with her father, they sent her to shock trauma. She's doing a lot better. She had 13 stitches over her eye. I was like, okay, Lord, like, this is the girl that pretty much cussed me out, told me I get everything, I'm gonna get everything I deserve. But I'm like, why do they always call on me? Like, what do y'all want from me? I felt like I told y'all last Wednesday, at this point, I'd rather have paid the check for them and I could be on my way than to have them keep calling me. Right. So I'm like, I'm the youngest of seven children. Of my mother's seven children, and I'm talking about they 9 years older than me and up. Why do y'all call me like that? I thought I was the baby that y'all keep saying. But she, when we finally found out what was wrong with her, you know, she came home a couple of days ago, they calling me. Well, her eyes swollen. What do we need to do? And I'm like, well, where's her mother? Well, I'm not her mother. But I'm like, okay, Lord, this is the person that cussed me out, told me I need to. So I said, okay, just get some wound solution, you know, clean her eye, put a warm rag on it. You know, the doctor said no ice at this point. And I said, well, she looked like her other eye is messed up too. So pretty much her face was. And so, you know, I talked to them and I'm like, I don't really communicate a lot with my family. I live a different life than they do. And I used to wonder why people tell me I'm different from the rest of my family. I never knew what that meant. Sometimes I used to get offended and be like, why am I different? Well, what's wrong with me? I like being different now. I accept that. I'm glad I'm different. It was just like, okay, I'm going to do this in love because I know that, you know, they always say, oh, you in church or you doing this. So let me show the love of Christ and that I am living different.
So I helped her. I bought her the stuff that she needed. Monday, I'm like, I'm at work. They calling me, trying to FaceTime me. I'm like, I'm at work. I'm trying to work, help take care of my brother, but y'all still calling me. Then my sister, then her mother called me. Well, did you talk to her? And I'm like, no, I haven't talked to her yet. I'm at work. I'm like, aren't you her mother? Like, you 9 years older than me. What? I'm not her doctor. What do you want me to tell her? So I told them again that she needed to do. And I'm like, I live this life that is really different from them. My sister has 7 kids and now you have a girlfriend. Now her daughter has a girlfriend. And I'm like, I don't get involved in y'all life because y'all do the party and the drinking. But my other sister told me she's calling you because this is the way God is showing her that she did something wrong to you. And I really didn't want to be bothered with you. I've been trying to keep my distance. So it's been like really hard for me this week. And I'm like, okay, God, what is it that you're trying to show me? And I listened to the stuff Denise was saying that you can't, you know, don't judge them. Don't get mad. Just pray for them.
Right. Right.
And I'm sitting here like, this is the person I try to give my all to my family and be there when they need me. But I'm like, it's okay that y'all think y'all just supposed to cuss me out and then get on the phone and say, hey, I need your help. But you mad at me because I didn't want to let you use my name to get a house. And then I have to think about when I'm going through my stuff, I get on the phone and I may text Pastor Hope or call mom. And I'm like, okay, they're at work and they're going through stuff. But I don't think about that when I'm in need and when I want to call and vent. So I just listened and I had to get over my hurt of the things she said to me. And I'm like, this is the same person. I allowed you to live in my house. I think about when your mother wanted to give you up and I was there. But you sit and talk to me like I was nothing. But I knew it wasn't just for me to just come out and say that. I know I just had to show love because I had to think about the things Christ endured for my sins.
Man.
When he didn't do anything wrong, he just took it. So I did. And every day that she's been home, she's been calling me and I've been asking how she doing. Has there any change? She's getting better. She told me today her eye is open. This is the first time she's been able to open her eye. And I'm just trying to get to that place where I'm trying to deal with them on their level. But I don't want to say I want to shut them out. I'm just at a place where I just don't really want to be bothered with them. I just try to keep my distance and stay in my own little space. Do call, I try to be helpful. I just get so tired that on Tuesday, I got off of work. I ended up just going to sleep. I'm trying to get to that point where I just don't let people wear me out and they just take and take. But I was happy to know she was doing better and that she was fine. So I really thank y'all for those words. I thank God for the process.
Yes.
That's right, the process. Process, yes.
Well, I do want to say this because I've been there with family members and I'm going to just tell you and be honest is that there's balance to this game too. I'm sorry. And you got to use wisdom, you need godly counsel for wisdom and stuff like that. It's one thing, because I always used to hear walk in love, walk in love, walk in love. And so that's all I knew about is walking on love. But at a point where I felt like it was being a repeat offender of people just doing, saying, and all of that, I had to say, wait a minute, time out, because I want to show the example what God looks like. I want to be there for you at the same token. So you got to really be careful and get godly counsel and wisdom, because I kept on hearing walk in love, walk in love, walk in love. And I'm like, wait a minute, this is not walking. I mean, I'm trying to, but, and I don't got a problem. I keep on doing it and doing it and doing it. But it just came to a point where it was a repeat offender, where I was like, you know what? I feel like I was being one of those people that's being abused. You know how the husband beat on you and then they say they love you the next day or whatever the case may be. And that's how I felt. And then it's like, you telling me to walk in love. So I was really challenged with that a while back. And then I just knew it had to be balance. There has to be balance. Because half of my family was always coming to me. I got the answer. I know Jesus. I can pray for you, all that. You can pray for him, but it was just like some things. That's why you really have to just really hear God, because we can get that mixed up sometimes, because we want to walk like God and be like God and be an example of God. But at the same token, if there's being, I don't know. I'm hearing your heart, but I just want to tell you there has to be balance. So I know Mom Jeanette and Pastor Carolyn, y'all a little bit more experienced with this whole love thing, but I just know I have to just tell you there has to be balance in this love walk with Christ.
Yeah, I thought you was going to be sentimental. And I'm glad you said that. You know, it says, you know, the Bible says you got to forgive them 70 times 7. And the greatest gift you can have for someone is forgiveness. Because once you start forgiving them, you're not mad anymore. You're not frustrated. You don't hold. I learned, you know, from being ministered to through moms and dad. You know, the greatest thing you can have. Because that's what the word said. God said that you got to forgive in order for him to forgive. And I always let that be my foundation with people I don't get along with or mistreated me intentionally. You know what I'm saying? And I said, I think a lot of things came up in when I did the
purge.
Yes, the purge. Time out.
Let me go back to presence and Lord.
Well, you know, Angela, let me just say, Jesus was abused. Jesus was mistreated. Jesus, a lot of bad stuff happened to him, but he stayed as Jesus.
Amen.
Now, I understand what Hope is saying about balance. And I'm telling you, as long as you pray into God, he will give you that balance.
That's right.
He will give it to you where you need to say no and where you need to say yes. But right now, the reason they're coming to you is because you're the closest thing to God that they can see.
That's right.
And it doesn't matter what they do to you on any other given day. When they need something, they're going to come to you. And it's the God in you that they're looking for. That's what they're searching for. And so sometimes us being Christians and being serious about what we do is that sometimes we can get a little abused and a little mistreated and a little taken advantage of. But know one thing for sure. The most important thing God has on this earth is family. That's what he created in the beginning. And it's usually the closest one to you is the one that can hurt you. So I see you going through a whole lot of pain and you're feeling a whole lot of stuff. But like Deacon Sly said, if you learn to forgive them, it won't hurt so bad. Because, and I can tell you from example, you know, I'm living right now, I just finally am starting to forgive and getting that resentment off of what happened 10, 15, 20 years ago.
Amen.
It's like giving somebody, it's like drinking the poison and expecting somebody else to die. So just know that you're going to be okay as long as you continue to put it in God's hand.
Amen.
Because God will tell you when to back off. He'll tell you when to back up. He'll tell you when to confront them. Because sooner or later, they're going to have to be confronted. But it has to be when they're at a position where they can receive it and not reject it.
That's right. Amen.
Okay? So you're going to be okay. You're going to be okay. And I know it hurts. I know. It's painful. But all that we're feeling, I always look to the pain Jesus went through on that cross. And when I'm going through this little mediocre stuff that I'm going through means absolutely nothing when I do the comparison. Okay? But all this is doing, your best lessons are learned through your pain.
That's right.
Amen. So just know you're going up. You're not leveling off. You're going up. And then when you get up, you're going to level off, but you're never going to get to where you're supposed to be until we get over on the other side. But we're working for that perfection. Okay? You're going to be okay, sweetheart.
Yes.
You're going to be okay. Okay? And tears are cleansing.
Yep.
Okay?
Oh, yeah.
Tears are cleansing.
Can I say something? I'm feeling a pull right now. God is saying he's working some things out in you. He's showing you some things. He's getting into those basements. He's getting into that attic of your heart, those places that maybe you forgot about. You know, he's working these things out for you. So don't take it lightly, because you won't feel this way after a while. Oh, Jesus.
Yes.
Working some things out in you, the way that you feel that forgiveness is coming. You're going to feel that soon, and you're going to have so much joy because you're able to forgive. You won't have this feeling anymore that you feel towards your family, whatever the hurt was, the offense, all the things that you have gone through, what they said about you, that's not going to matter. What matters is what God is doing in your life and what he is saying to you. So he is working some things out for you right now. Yes. And through you, he's getting into those deep places, that place where you swept that dirt up under that rug. He's getting underneath there. Right. He's cleaning out those places in your heart. He's about to work it out. So that those tears of cleansing, go ahead and cry, but just don't react in a certain way, you know, that'll make them look at you like, oh, well, I thought you said you were a Christian. Just keep doing what you're doing, but don't be anybody's doormat.
That's right. That's right.
Like, yes, there has to be balance, but seek God on what you should do, because you can love your family from a distance. And sometimes we have to cut people off, family or not.
That's right.
With that being said, just continue to seek God and to pray for them. Whatever it is that's going on, however they're feeling, whatever they got to say about you, it doesn't matter. You just keep on praying. You keep on seeking God, because he's working some things out. He's working things out. Those things that are in you, those things that you may have forgotten about, the way that you're feeling right now, you have to ask yourself, why do I feel this way, God? Why am I so upset with them? What other things, what is the root of what they have said or what they have done that is making me feel this way? You know, I usually don't say anything, but I'm feeling a pull. I'm feeling led by God right now. He's working all that stuff out, and he's cleansing you right now, because you have to say, God, search my heart, God.
Come on.
That's been my prayer for the last few weeks. And let me tell you, it is not a pretty sight. When you ask God to search your heart and to reveal some things to you, he's going to show you. He's going to show you exactly what's in there. And you're like, man, I didn't know I still felt like that. I didn't know those things were still harboring in there. That bitterness, all those things that have taken root, it's time to pull those things up, because those are like weeds and they're trying to choke out the anointing that he has on your life, and trying to choke out what he's trying to do with you. So the minute that you can get over this bitterness, this hurt, all this stuff that he's trying to work
work out. He will be able to use you in a way that you have never even thought possible. You quiet, I'm quiet, but guess what? He's about to make you so loud and people will have no choice but to listen. So allow him to continue to do this work in you and to clean you up and to pull those things out from the root, because he's working it out. We got to cut that stuff off. You look at the outer part and say, oh, like Pastor Holt was saying the other day, you look at the flowers and all the stuff on the outside. You can prune that stuff. You can cut it away and watch it grow. But deep down where those roots are, that stuff right there needs pulled up. So just let God pull those roots out, that bitterness, that anger, that hurt, that frustration, all that, because you're having all these things that you're dealing with your family, all this stuff. And you know, like he said, the closest ones that are to you are the ones that's going to hurt you the most, because you love them. You have that love for your family. If it's a stranger on the street, you're not going to care. If they say something to you, it's not even going to matter. So let God heal you from the past hurts. Let him pull that stuff up from the root, because that's what bitterness does. It takes root and it grows and it chokes out what God is trying to do in your life. So allow him to do it, to cut that stuff off. We're trying to pull that stuff up. We don't want to snip it here and cut it there and look at the outside and try to make it look all pretty. We want to tear that stuff up from the roots. We don't want that stuff to grow anymore. It's like those weeds, you know, we got to pull them weeds out. You can't let them grow, because they're going to choke out the beauty that's inside of you. Yeah. So allow him to do it.
Amen.
Preach, girl. Woo!
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
She just said it. She called it. Then she called it.
The Spirit of the Lord is here. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you,
Lord.
Thank you so much, Denise. Whoa. That was amazing. That was that's that power that mom
just God.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God.
We ain't quiet tonight.
Then Jeanette just said, Denise, your daughter so-and-so. And hello, somebody. There it is. There it is. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. That was nothing but the Holy Spirit. And that's what this fellowship is all about, keeping each other lifted up, pulling each other up, because when one hurts, we all hurt.
Thank you.
One is joyful, we are all joyful. When we arrive at a certain thing with a revelation, we are all happy. You know, and that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. All right.
Jeanette, you want to close us out?
We done asked you for an hour, Jeanette, to pray.
I know.
Who said that?
We did. Pastor Hope asked you to pray about 40
Who
minutes
said
ago.
That?
Now, we're just being led by the Spirit. I always said if somebody needs to go, because I respect their time, but you know, we can't just go.
Oh, yes.
So that's why I'm just being obedient. Like, I'm not cutting you guys off. I'm just letting, look how
we're just joking. Don't be getting all staunch in them, the Baptist church you was in, all staunch. We just playing, girl.
Well, another thing that's going on with Angela, yes, your family is like in the world. They're used to cursing. They're used to talking back, telling you this and that, because they have to fight with you because you're a different spirit. They don't like that you're with God.
Right.
So what you do, you don't have to put up with that. But when they call, by you not putting up with it, is when one want to curse you out. Well, you won't sign this for me. You still have your quiet, meek voice, because as long as you in a meek voice, you are pulling them in and says, wow, she didn't call me like I called her. She should have had, but you just say, you know, I would love to do that for you, but why should I co-sign for you? Because if I have to co-sign, then you're not able to, you might not be able to handle yourself. And I am trying to get myself together. But if I could, I would. And so they might call you everything. Oh, you this and that. You said, well, I'm sorry you feel that way. And then when you get off the phone, they don't hurt you because they done said so much. And everything they know of you that they think will hurt you, because it's not your sister. All right. It is Satan doing that. That's how we got to wrestle against flesh and blood. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. Right. Your sister is flesh and blood. Your family is flesh and blood. You got to remember who you're talking to. And yes. then you got to show them that you are God spirit. Amen.
All right.
Okay. So you have to talk nice to them and say, well, listen, if you're going to continue calling me, cursing me out, well, I'm not going to receive your call like that. But when you want to talk nice to me, you're perfectly welcome to call me. Amen. All in a nice, gentle voice. Amen. They might don't hear it then. They might call you something hanging up. But that's okay. You know it ain't them. It was Satan that did that. And that's the mindset got to get there. And then if you're talking back to them like they're talking back to you, then you just need to read the word a little bit more.
Yes.
Go read. Yes. Let God direct you where to read at. And hey, the one how he tempted Jesus. Jesus didn't go for it. Everything he said was in a nice, quiet voice. He could have threw Satan off the mountain.
Yeah. But he didn't. Hello, somebody.
You understand? He just had everything in a meat voice. Because, see, you're the closest thing, like they said to him, and you're the one that God appointed to help them come to the kingdom.
Right, that's right.
So you say, you don't know God, what to do? You just read that word, put it, you got a cell phone, everybody listen to everything else on the cell phone and stroll on Facebook. Well, how come you can't listen to the word of God?
Right, right.
The whole time in your ear or whatever, on your time. And I am just like, okay. It kept saying, say something to Angela. Say something to Angela. But when I was in prayer today, all of y'all on, God had said, it is well. In my prayer this morning, I called out each one of y'all names and said, it is well.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord.
So, Pastor Carolyn, it is well. Pastor Hope, it is well. Deacon Say, it is well. Angela, it is well. And Denise, it is well. Jeanette, it is well. It is well in our soul. We can breathe today. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. We could share the word. We know you, God. And we continue asking you to shape and mold in us and the people you want us to be, Lord. Let us continue walking on a narrow road, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you. And the wide is the road to destruction, Lord. Let us not look at the wide road because it's in destruction and vain, but look and see and pray that we can save those people that don't know what they're doing, what they're saying, that they are belong to Satan, the enemy, the devil that comes to steal, destroy. And Lord, just let people see your light so shine in us, Lord. We just thank you for the word that Denise brought today, Lord. Continue giving her confidence, Lord. Expand her territory, Lord, and her messages and her artwork and her children in the name of Jesus. And we just thank you, Father. We thank you for our covenant. We thank you for our apostles, our evangelists, our teachers. I forgot what my net was.
Thank you.
My own daughter. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. But bless the Lord. Bless little Larry. And Lord, it is well with all of us. And Lord, we just thank you. We appreciate you. Make our way prosper this week, Lord. Let us look towards the high mark of your high calling and keep pressing towards you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You're great, Bible study. And Angela, I'll leave you on this note. I'll let you laugh on this one because I have an aunt that's like Medea to the fifth power, okay? And she like goes from 0 to 1,000 veins popping the forehead and she just want to say hi. So like when I see that number pop up, I just be like, Lord, I'm gonna need you to cover me. I need you to cover my mind, cover my heart. So sometimes you gotta pray before them family members call you and you see that number come up just to keep you equipped to make sure that you're on the right path, because it works. Trust me when I do. They keep screaming, yelling, and all of that, and you just have the peace of God. So sometimes even when you see that number, you just say, Lord, use me. Tell me what I need to say, what I need to hear, what I don't, you know, like whatever. But my aunt taught me that very well.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
It works. Try it.
Amen. I'm going to just say this because I'm leaving. And I think Jeanette probably knows what the scripture is because you've been great lately with it. When the lady needed the healing and she just, Jesus said, who touched his garment? A lot of time, people don't know how to receive good or want good because we was once there, but we all was there when we reach for that garment. Sometimes, and I just want you to see it, because sometimes we have to see it. I want to see it in a different way. That's why I ask God to always let me see it the way he see it. You know, sometimes maybe your family just reaching for your garment because you're the closest thing they see to anything around them that's symbolic to the word. You know, so we've been there where we were trying to reach for that healing, and they might just be, they could be just reaching for the garment, just don't know how. I know I was there. I know a lot of us was there. So I always wanted, I just want to pray over them. And because when it comes to goodness, a lot of people don't know how to receive it. They more angry because they want it. So I just want you to understand that at the end of the day, Angela, you know, forgive them. And they might be reaching because they don't know how to do it no other way right now. I know moms and dad taught me. You know, so I just want to help you see it from a positive way, because a lot of times people do stuff that's so negative, but they looking for healing.
Hurt people.
Yeah, amen. Amen.
I want to tell you, Angela, my sister and I, we got in an argument one day. Now, we were just talking. I just called her up, and we were talking about old things, and I happened to mention something about her kid, my niece. When my niece was a baby, I took care of the baby a lot. She was running the street, but she forgot that she did that, and she used to leave the baby next door to the neighbor when I was a neighbor to keep the baby, and she says, no, I didn't. Now, she took good care of the baby. The baby, like she was a little silver spoon baby with the white thing over the bed canopy and all the white stuff and all the good toys. But we were just talking, and then I said that. She just blew up. Why would you say that? Why would you say I didn't take care of my kid? I did not say you didn't take care of your kid. I said that you remember when you used to live it? Well, boy, did she give it to me. She hung up the phone and everything to tell you that, hey, and this happened like 2 months ago. So what I did, I texted her a thing that I would not say that she didn't take care of her kid in an ill matter way. You know, that I love her. Please forgive me that you misunderstood what I said. That's why I say talking in good voice. So she never answered it back. So the meantime, what I was doing every time I pray, I put her in the prayer that Lord give her understanding. She's my sister. I don't want her to carry the anger. And if I did something wrong by saying that, forgive me and forgive her as well. And then a couple of weeks ago, who calls me on the phone? My sister.
Amen.
She says, Jeanette, did you take the COBRA shot? Just like nothing ever happened. And that's the way you have to keep them. You have to wait a little bit. They curse you out. hang that phone up, pray for them, and wait to God tell you to pick up the phone.
Yes.
And
yes.
Then you'll see how God worked, because see, one, you didn't talk to him. You was putting the Holy Ghost on him.
All right.
And so I want you to know that you're not the only one that argued with family. And see, I was nice that day. Yeah. Because sometimes you step on my toes. I have to go and say, I need everything. And I need drenched with water. I need to be transformed back. Everybody have a day. So it's nothing wrong with you. But if you stay in the word, if you read the word, try to be a doer of the word.
Amen.
It'll be so much better. And look, like I said, don't try to do it. Don't try to help Jesus fix you.
Amen.
He might not be fixing that right now. You could be a smoker. He might be trying to get you not to smoke cigarettes.
Amen.
See, I was a smoker, and the people at the church was pulling me down. Like, I really thought that if I didn't stop smoking, I wouldn't go to heaven.
Yeah.
But that wasn't God. That's not to tell anybody to smoke, because you'll die or you have problems. You have a heart attack. I'm not telling people to smoke, but I'm saying that's not what God was helping me out with at that time. But the people, they gonna help me out with cigarettes, which is disturbing me from hearing what God said. See, God wanted me to not be afraid, be more confident. So he kept putting me in places that I would not be comfortable in. And then I leave or say something wrong, see, my mouth was big. So I like to run things. And so when I say the wrong thing, I just leave because I got it on the other person. But then I learned that, see, that's why God put me in an uncomfortable place, because he's teaching me how to keep my mouth closed, only say yes and nay, and pull the people in so they can hear you with the word that you have to say. So that's what God was doing to me, to every time I get insulted and I didn't want to do whatever they say do, and I'm pointing, well, she ain't doing it. I did this all for a whole week. I cleaned the commode for the last four Saturdays, and she didn't do nothing but dust the chairs. How come she don't clean the commode? Well, see, they put me right back in the same position. For 18 years, when I got the picture, I cleaned the bathroom and every other place if they came or if they didn't, because God wanted me to hear. And I believe I wanted, you know, you keep his sanctuary clean. But that was one of the things God had for me, not that I smoke cigarettes, that I will be obedient, that to not to accuse somebody else of what they doing, but do what he has me to do. I got a little off in something, but I hope you got something.
Amen.
Thank you.
To make you feel that you ain't the only one.
Nope.
He's just
amen.
Fixing amen. You.
Love y'all.
It's bedtime now.
Yeah. Amen. All right. Love you guys. See you.
I love all of y'all. It was so beautiful.
See you tomorrow night.
Okay.
Love y'all.
Oh, did you do your heart,
Jeanette? Wait.
Do your heart. Oh, you gonna do this one? You ain't gonna do the other one?
No, I thought I did.
No, go to your reaction.
Dave.
I got it. I got Al's tablet.
Okay. Good night.
No, they good say night.
Good night. Good night. I'm gonna press something.
Uh-oh, I did something. But love you guys. God bless you. Thank you.
I don't know how to get off. I'm on Al's tablet. Oh, okay.
Good night.
Oh, that's because I'm pressing with my fingers.